All right, so grab a hard copy Bible if you got one in your home, or open up a Bible app and turn to Psalm 112. You can open up another browser or whatever you want to do. But thanks for joining us. We're glad you're online worshiping with us and joining us for online church. So there's a British novelist whose name was David Lodge, and in an introduction to one of his books, tells a story about being in a theater watching a performance of a satirical review that he had helped write. Now, a review is basically, it's like sketches that are parodies or commentary on recent events or fads or trends. And so it's often very tongue-in-cheek. And he was someone who had written what was going on stage and sitting out in the audience as a writer. He recalls that in one sketch, there was a character who was being very nonchalant, very indifferent, kind of too cool for school during a job interview. And this character has a transistor radio up to his ear. And the character, the actor, actually would tune into a radio channel and a live broadcast whenever he would do this sketch. So he'd turn it on and people would hear from the radio waves something coming from that radio. Well, during that scene, the actor, when he turned on the radio in the middle of the sketch, a real-time announcement came through that President John F. Kennedy had just been shot. And suddenly the actor, like, frantically tried to turn off the radio immediately, but it had already kind of reverberated through the room, like, whoa. And reality set in and reality interrupted what was going on stage. And I think that's such an interesting metaphor, because whenever something goes on that's kind of tragic or, whoa, that's real, you know, whatever's going on in life. I mean, a lot of people, you know, let's just be honest, they get to go home in the evening and like, okay, I just had a day of work and now it's time for Netflix, Hulu, or life goes back to what they're used to doing, goals that they've been working on. You know, it might be parenting, it might be stuff going on like getting out of debt they're focused on or working on their marriage. But life is going on, and every once in a while, something we just don't expect to happen just rings through reality, and we're like, whoa, man, who saw this coming? And everything is interrupted. The proverbial transistor radio broadcast announces bad news, and we're shocked. I remember back when I was in sixth grade, it was a big, big deal that school classrooms, school students all around the country were tuning in to watch the space shuttle Challenger take off. And it was a big deal that astronauts were going to space, but there was a teacher named Krista McCullough that was getting to go to space, and I'm like, wow, this is so cool. And in my sixth grade classroom, we gathered around to watch the TV set that was rolled in on wheels, you know, and there's a TV up there, and this is back in the day. And so they rolled it in, and we watched, and the tragedy that happened is the shuttle goes up in the air, and the Challenger explodes in front of us live. And it was just this transistor radio broadcast moment of like, whoa, that just happened. And it was so surreal. It was shocking. I remember, for those of you who are old enough to remember, 9/11 attacks. And everybody remembers, if they're old enough, where they were at in those moments. My wife Shannon and I lived in the Washington, D.C. area. And of course, one plane flew into the Pentagon, crashed into the Pentagon. But I remember in the middle of that, just turning on live television and seeing the second plane hit the second tower, and just the shock of that, like, whoa, it was that transistor radio moment of like, is this really happening right now? This is so surreal and shocking. Well, this crisis is similar in many ways, but it's also different in some ways. This crisis, it kind of feels like there's been this slow-moving train coming at us. It hasn't been this boom, quick, wow, where did this come from? It's been a slow-moving train. You know, a little bit, I hate to, you know, use the analogy, but it's been kind of like the Y2K scare, like slowly coming at us, you know? And like, it's coming, but that ended up being a big wah, wah. But we were waiting for it, and it was slow-moving. It might be if you live along the coast or have lived down south, like a hurricane that you know is approaching, and just kind of prepping, and how do we prep? What do we do? That's what this coronavirus thing has felt like to me. And honestly, my knee-jerk reactions, I'm talking about me. my knee-jerk reactions aren't always Christ-like or godly. Like, the first things that come to mind often are selfish, safety, invest in the stock market, you know, that kind of stuff. But, I mean, it really does kind of bring out some of the truths about ourselves when stuff like this goes down. You know, if your first reaction is political, you know, everything's just about, this is about politics, this is about politics, and it's an election year, and the government released this virus. If your reactions are political, then politics might be your God. And that's a reality. They're like, whoa, that's the first thing I go to with this is politics? Or if your first reaction to it is financial, money might be your God. Or if your first reaction is to load up ammo for all your guns, you might be a redneck, okay? So, you know, I know for me, this pandemic virus has totally ruined my March Madness bracket. You know, a lot of people, it's like, sports are gone, which I totally concur. But of course, we get it. Like, it's a big deal. And honestly, I don't keep up with the news a lot and just watch for all the stories going on. But the truth is, this is one story I've been watching kind of since the beginning. And I remember hearing something called the coronavirus and me looking up, what is a coronavirus? And hearing that there was a city in China, that there was outbreak, and hearing that they locked down that city, and it was the time in history where they've tried to lock down the most people, like nobody come or go. And I remember they shut down the Chinese New Year, which was a big deal there. And then eventually the first case outside of the city. Then eventually the first case outside of China, then Italy, the U.S., and now my home county, Cuyahoga County. And so it's been like a slow-moving train. Like, this is so surreal and strange, but still has that feel of a broadcast coming through the transistor radio of like, wow, how do we respond? And one thing I've been reminded of this week, honestly, is that this whole planet is just one small family, to be honest. We are the pale blue dot in the solar system. I mean, as big as this world is, as many people as there are, this is one family. I mean, if you get your mind around it, this all started probably from one bat in contact with one human being. And it just continues. One person contracted the coronavirus. Now everyone on the planet is paying attention. And people in Cuyahoga County, my county, are paying attention and have it. And Ohio schools have been shut down by Governor DeWine. It's a small world. We are all related. We're all the same. We're all beautiful, valuable human beings, as Scripture teaches us. We are all made in the image of God. And so wherever you are watching from, if you're from one of Momentum's two campuses or some other part of the country or some other part of the world, welcome. I hope to be an encouragement to you, and we're so glad you're with us and really want to help you move forward spiritually to love God, love people, and make disciples or students or apprentices of Jesus who make disciples. And so if you turn to Psalm 112, again, in a Bible app or in a hard copy Bible, I'll be reading from the New International Version if the words I read are just slightly adjusted from what you read. But in Psalm 112, it's basically about God's presence in difficult times. Psalm 112, starting with verse 1, says this: "Praise the Lord. Blessed are those who fear the Lord, who find great delight in His commands." Now, really what this is just talking about is this whole thing is talking about the hashtag blessed person, okay? It's basically saying, okay, it starts with a fear of the Lord. Now, that doesn't just mean like I cower at the greatness of the Creator. Fear of the Lord means like a respect, like an appropriate awe level for God. And that really ultimately leads to a love for and a relationship with God, that God is loving and He's all-powerful. So it really begins with fear the Lord, those who fear the Lord, and then it really kind of ends with people who find great delight in His commands, inferring, man, God, I get it. You are looking out for my best interests. Like, You're a loving, compassionate, and powerful Heavenly Father. You're not just trying to be an almighty party pooper. You're giving me commands because You know how You've created me and what would fill the voids in my life. And so the concept here is that a wise child of God depends on the instruction of a wise, loving, Heavenly Father. And so verse 2 goes on to say, their children, these godly people that love and follow the instructions of God, their children, I love this, will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright or the godly will be blessed. It says wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. Now, here it shows us that the godliness or trust and obedience in God and imitating God is really what godliness means. I will imitate God. It's rewarded in three ways, really. First, it's rewarded in this life. And so talks about how there's wealth and riches in their houses. And so some of that is talking about some like monetary, financial, that kind of stuff or whatever. Like these people be blessed. But really also we know from Scripture and from life, wealth and riches aren't just financial. Okay, they are relational, they are parental, they're marital, they're spiritual. And so it's saying, man, in this life, godliness, it has a payoff because you will be spiritually wealthy. The Bible talks about people who are financially rich, but spiritually poor. And it also talks about people who are financially poor, yet spiritually they are wealthy and they have riches that are untold and are totally different than financial riches. And so that's one way you're blessed in this life. You're also blessed, godliness is, in future generations. I love what it says about man, the generations, the children of godly people, they will be mighty in the land. Your faith, your relationship with God has a legacy that ripple effects through your children that they catch from you, and they're a blessing to the people around them. And then the third thing is this, godliness is rewarded in the life to come. I mean, it's an eternity with that loving, powerful Heavenly Father. Eternity, heaven, the afterlife, really what that means is community with God and with God's people, with God's family. And so that is the hope that we have when we're godly, that God matters here and now and how we walk through this life. It matters for the next generation that we're influencing and our children and our grandchildren. And we have this hope that we get to be with our Heavenly Father when we're godly and we follow Him. Now, so far, this psalm sounds very utopian, doesn't it? It sounds very like, oh, that's very sweet. A lot of rainbows, a lot of butterflies, a lot of unicorns and Skittles, okay? And so there's glitter, there's Happy Meals. This sounds like, wow, faith is just a big trip to Disneyland. Not right now, but it's a big trip to Disneyland, you know, Disney World. It's a Betty Crocker family. It's families wearing sweater vests and cardigans. This is very Little House on the Prairie, Seventh Heaven, and Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood so far, right? Okay, so, but here's the deal. That's not what a life of faith looks like. It just really isn't, and Scripture constantly acknowledges this, that there are transistor radio moments constantly for people. And so in the next part of the psalm, here comes the realism. Here comes the real life. Here comes the rain clouds over the parade, over the picnic. Here comes the storm that Curtis just read about from the end of Matthew chapter 7. Here comes the phone call from the doctor. Here comes the Dear John letter. Here comes the bad news through the transistor radio. Verse 4. It says, acknowledging that this stuff happens, even in darkness, which is just a metaphor for tragic calamity, bad times, even in darkness, I love this, light dawns for the upright. Like even in those bad times, there is light dawning for those who love and follow God and have a relationship with Him. For those who are gracious and compassionate and righteous. Now, this verse is kind of ambiguous as to where does the light come from? And there can be two meanings, which is even in darkness, light dawns, the light of God. Like God, you know, shines light for us. We have this hope that we see God's light through all this. Or really, the context seems to infer even in darkness, light dawns from these kind of righteous people we've been describing that love God, that they're a light for others, even in dark times. And the Hebrew language, was what this was originally written in, is ambiguous. I'd say the answer is both. It's the light of God and the hope that He gives, but also light shining on earth because we're imitating God. Again, that's godliness. That man, even in darkness, light dawns for the upright, for those who are gracious and compassionate and righteous. Just a beautiful metaphor, light being a joy of life. you still have a joy of life in darkness because of the hope that we have in God. And so then verse 5 goes on to say this: good or contentment, well-being, will come to those who are generous and lend freely, who conduct their affairs with justice. How applicable is that right now? Good will come to those who are generous and lend freely, who conduct their affairs with justice. Surely the righteous or the godly, those who love God, will never be shaken, and they will be remembered forever. So be generous, lend freely. The godly will never be shaken. Otherwise, the person who is godly, wise, the child who listens to the Heavenly Father's instructions, they will leave a legacy and never be forgotten. Do you remember that time when this happened? Do you remember who lent to us, who gave to us? It was a godly person. It was someone who loves Jesus. And then I love this last verse, and this is the last one we'll cover. This is really where I'll camp out for just a second. It says this: they will have no fear of bad news. Their hearts are steadfast, trusting in the Lord. So people who have this love, fear, respect, awe for God, and they follow God in obedience, as Curtis read earlier in Matthew 7, their house is built on the rock and not sand of Jesus' teachings. Things aren't constantly shifting with news. They have the light of life, which is a joy of life. So therefore, these godly people who walk with God will have no fear of bad news. We don't have to fear bad news. We have way too much hope for that. How do we fear bad news when we have so much hope that when we follow and we imitate and obey God, man, we have all this hope. Why would we ever fear bad news? But the harsh reality is, as the psalm acknowledged, darkness comes. Things show up. The transistor radio rings through reality, shuts down things that were just commonplace, normal routines. And it could happen for you individually sometimes outside of this crisis, maybe within it, where for someone who's walking with God, those walking to follow Jesus, adversity is always crouching and waiting. It is always crouching and waiting. And sometimes, as right now, this adversity, it's a global thing. Like right now, adversity is a global crisis. And so this psalm acknowledges the reality of darkness, a metaphor for calamity and disastrous times. Bad news or any reason to fear. And in the next verse that we won't get into, it talks about foes or enemies. So the bad news through the transistor radio. But the bottom line is this: people who trust and obey God don't have to live in fear of bad news. We have too much hope for that. We don't have to fear. We have too much hope to be spending our time just living in fear and anxiety. In fact, the most repeated command, Curtis and I have constantly reminded Momentum of this, the most repeated command in Scripture is, do not be afraid. God's too strong. He's too powerful. He's a loving Heavenly Father. We have too much hope to be afraid, so don't be afraid. As followers of Jesus, we are people of compassion, of faith, of lending, of generosity. We are not people of panic and fear. Do not join in the hysteria. We have way too much hope to do that. Now, these are unprecedented and confusing times, and I think that when it's like that for me, what's really helpful is to go back to basics. And so I just want to very, very simply, very shortly remind you, for people who follow Jesus, our mission is to hang our hats on the major teachings of Jesus. And that's why we say that Momentum, our mission, is to move people forward, to love God, love people. Love God's number one. Love people's a very close second. And make disciples, students of Jesus, apprentices of Jesus, who make disciples. And those are three major teachings. The great commandments of Jesus is number one, this is number two. And the great commission, the mission given to us by Jesus to go make disciples of all the earth. And so, love God. How can you do that right now? Real simple. Stay calm and be prayerful. Okay? Don't freak out. Have conversation with God. Stay calm and be prayerful. A lot of times, if you follow Jesus or you're trying to grow spiritually, one of the first starting points, the basic of all basics, is to begin reading the Bible. And a lot of times we're like, man, I just don't have time for that. I'm going to guess in the next 3 weeks, You have more time than usual for that, right? So, you know, people are out of school. You know, some people are off work. There's just a lot of staying home, a lot of we want to go there, but that's closed. We got to stay 6 feet away from each other, that kind of stuff. So really take this time to start in the Gospel of Matthew, where Curtis read. He read out of Matthew 7. And just to start in Matthew, read a paragraph a day, a short chapter a day, and just root yourself in those scriptures, because you will take comfort in the teachings of Jesus as the whole world around you feels like it's shifting sand. You can begin to build your home and your life on the rock, which is Jesus's teachings. Love people. How do I do that in the midst of this? Well, we love to say at Momentum that we want to be good news to other people. Jesus came to be good news. The word for good news, gospel. Gospel just means good news. So Jesus was good news for people over and over and over. So we want to be Jesus's people and be good news to others. Honestly, that's part of the reason we're not having public services. We want to be good news to the community by helping slow down the spread of a virus that hospitals wouldn't be able to handle if everybody got it at the same time. So let's be good news, and let's fall in line with the wisdom of government. Let's fall in line with the wisdom of people that we're leaning on for counsel and say, yeah, let's help. Be good news to the community by helping slow this down and not getting everybody together in the same room. We're not going to live in fear, but we're going to love people by being good news. We're going to check in on each other. It's so simple, but one of the ways that we can love people is if you just simply check in on each other. If you're in a Mo group, I'd say top of the list is check in on your spiritual family. A Mo group typically are groups of people, 6 to 12, 10 to 15, that meet in homes throughout greater Cleveland. And they're really spiritual family. They're a band of brothers together. So check in on each other. Just a text. How are you doing? Do you need anything? That kind of stuff. And do that for your neighbors also. If you can find a way to check in on your neighbors, who I'm going to guess, if you're like me, most of them are strangers to you, okay, just the day and age we live in and the transient culture we live in, but check in on your neighbors, especially if you have a widow who lives across the street or next door, anyone older or someone that might be more susceptible, just offer, hey, I'm going to sanitize and all that stuff, but is there anything I can get for you? Can I run an errand for you? And offer to serve Momentum's beloved older people and anyone of any age that really might be vulnerable to coronavirus, and just say, hey, is there any way? If you don't want me to come over, that's totally fine, but can I do something for you? Can I run an errand? We always say in Mo groups, when someone has a crisis in a Mo group, we rally to that person. The rest of the Mo group rallies to that person. It's our spiritual family. It might look a little bit different right now. Not everybody wants everybody showing up, you know, that kind of thing, but we still rally to them with texts, scripture, encouragement, prayers. Can I do anything for you? Can I help? And make disciples who make disciples. Really, this is just an unprecedented opportunity to have conversations that explain to people, God says this. When you walk with God, He promises to give you the peace of God that transcends understanding. It might not make sense to people around you that you have the light of life, this light, this hope. That might not make sense, but that we can explain to people in Christ, we have the peace of God that transcends understanding. Meaning it doesn't even really seem to make sense from the outside, but I have too much hope to be freaking out and living in fear and going nuts. I can pray for people. I can be cautious about my actions, be considerate, but not live in fear. And that's helping people win. That is helping people win. One challenge I have for Momentum and anyone who would accept it is there's a few churches around Northeast Ohio. They're kind of teaming up, locking arms to say, hey, let's make Tuesday a time of prayer. You can pray all week. That's great. But we're going to focus also on Tuesday saying, hey, let's pray and fast about this. Everything seems reactionary when something like this happens, like, whoa, reaction, don't do this, don't touch that. So we want to do something on offense. And let's say, okay, an offensive way that we can do something is to pray and fast on Tuesdays. Now, what that means is to say, I'm going to give up one meal or two or three meals. That's totally up to you. And it's up to you if you can handle that health-wise or whatever. But to give up one meal or two meal or three meals to say, in the time that I would be eating, I'm going to stop and I'm going to pray. And I'm going to pray about this coronavirus. I'm going to pray for the safety of people on our planet, for people in my county, for people in my schools, in my home. And just to say, man, this is really, really a big deal, because there are individuals, for people who momentum that you know, who are more susceptible to this than the regular person. And to maybe lift those people up in prayer that you know, I'm concerned and I want to pray for that person, that they'll be protected and that God will have his hand on them. But thank you that they have a hope that helps them not fear what's going on. So we're going to pray on Tuesdays, and there are other followers of Jesus throughout Northeast Ohio and the state who are doing that with us on Tuesdays. But we have a lot of people with momentum who are vulnerable and could maybe use the offer to be served or these prayers on their behalf. I know somebody who's come to mind a lot, and I haven't told her I'd say this, but I've had somebody who's come to mind a lot in the last few weeks, and that's been a friend of mine at Momentum, Miss Joyce Hanlon. And I've really just thought, of like, man, I love Joyce Hanlon, and I don't want anything to happen for her. So on Tuesday, I guarantee you, she is one of the people specifically that I'm going to lift up in prayer, because I want her to be protected. At traditional churches, Miss Joyce Hanlon is what you might call a senior saint. Okay, that's what traditional churches call them. That means she's older. And if she were here in this room, she would run on the stage and punch me in the gut right now. Not true, but I love Joyce. I cannot imagine. I would be so brokenhearted if anything ever happened to Joyce Hanlon, but I would be glad that one day I will get to have community with her in heaven. But I'm going to pray for her because I want her to be protected during this virus. I love Joyce Hanlon. But there are also people younger than Joyce Hanlon. There's Jamie Berna, who is in my Mo group, who has lots of different health issues. I don't know that any of them are ones that make her susceptible to the coronavirus, but she has everything. You name it, she's got it. I mean, she's had organ transplants, all kinds of stuff. And so I'm going to pray for Jamie Berna on Tuesdays. Lauren Love leads Mo Kids here at this campus, Twinsburg, Macedonia. She's a young mother, just had a baby recently, her second child with her husband, Mike. She has Crohn's disease, and I think that makes her immune system a little deficient. So I'm going to pray for my friend, Lauren Love. KJ Teal, Curtis, the campus minister here at Twinsburg, Macedonia, one of his daughters, KJ, has a weakened immune system. And there's a young person that I want to pray for, lift KJ's name up and say, that's somebody I want to pray for on Tuesday. We have new babies at Momentum. I don't know how coronavirus, I'm not smart enough to know, but I do know we got some new babies at each campus. We got Levi Ludwig at Garfield Heights campus and Grace McGill at the Twinsburg Macedonia campus. I want to lift up babies that I know just because I'm like, they're super young and I want them to be protected. So God, please protect them. If you're new, I want to kind of share one thought with you before I close. If it's your first time or you're tuning in because you're like, whoa, the reality, the transistor radio, it's all just come through. And I really want to seek God. I need some comforting words, some instruction, some direction. I want to share this with you. In 2008, I read a book by a guy named David Olson. It was called The American Church in Crisis. That's a happy title for you, isn't it? And it was a research-based book from databases of over 200,000 American churches. And the author, David Olson, said this. He said, church attendance for the American church this millennium, remember this is written in 2008, for this millennium peaked during the five Sundays following the 9/11 attacks. The national trauma sent worshipers to the church services in record numbers, but the memory of the event and the attraction to church was short-lived. On the sixth Sunday, attendance returned to normal. Since then, the American church attendance has declined in an unprecedented fashion. Most of the deterioration is in the mainline, kind of old school Protestant denominations like Presbyterian USA, United Methodist, and Roman Catholic churches, although some evangelical groups are also struggling. And then David Olson just asked this question, what does that tell us about the American church? And what does that tell us about our culture? And I would add, what does that tell us about humanity, human beings, human nature in general? And my thoughts are this. What does it tell us about our culture, humanity? I would just say that human tendency, my tendency, is to only turn to God when there's an emergency. The joke is when we're in a tight bind, like, God, I just need you to show up right now. I'll do anything, you know. You just help me out right now. And then once the crisis is over, boom, we're good. Then there's something like this, a global crisis, and we turn to God like, God, this is a big emergency. Please protect my family. But the truth is, human nature is not to seek God or a relationship with God in good times, or to invite him in those regular things in life, like our life goals that we're setting, or our friendships, or marriage, or parenting, or just our everyday fears and anxieties that God cares greatly about. And so I think that's what it tells us about human tendency, is we run to God in emergencies, but it's learning to lean on God and trust God and delight in his commandments during regular times of our life. What does this tell us about the American church, on the other hand? Well, it might mean that when people showed up at church from 9/11, those churches weren't very friendly. Maybe they were very cliquish. Who knows? I don't know. I mean, lots of churches, so some churches probably knocked it out of the park loving newcomers. Others probably didn't. It's also probably to say that many churches might be very irrelevant, and that when they showed up, maybe they got 5 weeks of stuff that was like, that was kind of comforting from a very big picture standpoint, but I don't know how that would matter to my life the rest of the year. They weren't speaking to issues that mattered to people, you know, with a godly perspective. Maybe they just weren't helpful. Maybe it was boring. Maybe they spoke in a language that people didn't understand. I don't even know what they're talking about. And that's stuff that the church can learn from, that momentum can learn from, to say, man, we welcome people with open arms. We're super excited when ever somebody new shows up at Momentum, and we want to speak their language. We want to love them. We want to love their children, and we want to be helpful. We want to help people win spiritually. And so for those of you joining us online and it's your first time, maybe you haven't been to church in a long, long time, and I just want to say to you, welcome. It is a huge spiritual step. It may have taken great courage for you just to log in, even if you're by yourself, to say, I'm going to engage with a church. And so I want to say, man, huge spiritual step. Welcome. I'm very proud of you. And if you don't go to church somewhere regularly, I just want to say, I would love to be your pastor. I would love to kind of help walk you through this crisis and beyond. And we would love to be your church family, your spiritual squad, to rally around you and help you figure out what it means to grow spiritually and help you win spiritually. So I'd like to just challenge you with this thought. Try five. And what I mean by that is just simply, you might show up once this is all over and we're done meeting online and we're having public services again and we're all washing our hands every 90 seconds and squirting, you know, sanitizer and all that kind of stuff. But when you show up for the first time, when we come back together, I would encourage you, starting at that point, to try five in person around people. Not just 1 week where you're like, man, that message didn't really speak to me, but to say, I'm going to come 5 weeks in a row, and then I'm going to ask the question, is God speaking to me through what's being taught from the scriptures? Is Jesus showing up in my life in some kind of way that I'm like, wow, that's no coincidence in the last 5 weeks that this has been happening? To kind of put God on the line and say, God, I'm showing up seeking you. Make yourself real to me. Speak to me. Reveal yourself to me in some way, but not just to be one and done, but to say, I'm going to lean into this and I'm going to try five and see if these godly teachers at Momentum don't have an impact on my small children and these people that are connecting with me and engaging with me, if they might not just be the people that I need to lean on and have this kind of crowd around me in the future moving forward. We want to help you win spiritually. As a single person, someone trying to find victory over addiction, as someone trying to battle depression, we want to help you win at your job or helping you find your calling or developing your gifts. But most of all, we want to help you win spiritually. Let's pray.